And I have a confession to make. It's true that New York Magazine voted me as one of the 100 smartest people in New York. However, in all fairness, I have to admit that Madonna also made that same list. So how authoritative could that list be? Now today, I'm going to take you on a guided tour of the future. And it's always dangerous to make predictions. I quote from the physicist Niels Bohr. Bohr once said, quote, "Prediction is awfully hard to do, especially if it's about the future." And we physicists, we invented the laser. We invented the transistor. We helped to create the internet. We wrote the World Wide Web. We created television, radio, x-rays, almost everything you see in the 20th century, we helped to create. But when we physicists and computer scientists created the internet, one scientist made a prediction, and he hoped that the internet would become a forum of high culture, high art, and high society. Well, today we know that 5% of the internet is pornography. But that's because teenage boys log on to the internet, not you guys. Just wait till the grandmas and grandpas log on to the internet. Then 50% of the internet will be pornography. Now, you may think that we physicists know it all. So let me tell you a little story about the dangers of knowing it all. Over 200 years ago, we had the Great French Revolution, and many people lost their heads to the guillotine. Well, one day, there were three gentlemen about to lose their head to the guillotine. There was a priest, a lawyer, and a theoretical physicist, just like Paul and me. So they put the priest's head on the chopping block, and they asked him, "Do you have any last words before we cut your priestly head off?" And the priest said, "Yes, yes, I have some last words." And he said, "Maybe God from above, surely he will set me free." Well, all eyes were on the blade. The blade rose, and the blade fell, swish, and it stopped right before it hit the neck of the priest. Well, the crowd had never seen this before. "Magic," they said. "God has spoken," the mob said. "Let the priest go." And now let's see about the lawyer. Yes, the lawyer. Now the bloodlust was really starting. Yes, the lawyer. We want his head. So they asked the lawyer, "Do you have any last words?" And he said, "Yes." He said, "Maybe justice. Yes, the spirit of justice shall set me free." Well, all eyes were on the blade. The blade came down, swoosh, and it stopped right before it hit the neck of the lawyer. Well, the crowd was amazed, dancing in the streets of Paris. They said, "Let there be a holiday. God has spoken. Justice has spoken." And now let's see about that theoretical physicist. So they put the physicist's head on the chopping block, and they asked him, "Do you have any last words before we cut your physicist's head off?" And he said, "Yeah, yeah, I got some last words." And he said, "You know, I don't know too much about God, and I know even less about the law, but I do know one thing. If you look up, you'll see that the rope is stuck on the pulley." And then he said, "If you remove the rope, the blade should come down real good." Big mistake. Big mistake. Well, the rope came down, the blade came down, and the poor physicist's head came down. And it just goes to show you that sometimes we physicists have to know when to keep our mouths shut. Nonetheless, today I will talk about the impossible. Things that are impossible today, but maybe possible in the coming decades, centuries, maybe millennia. And some things which are probably just downright impossible. For example, how many people here have seen the movie 2001? Raise your hand. Now, how many people have understood that movie? Raise your hand. About two people. How many people have seen the movie Back to the Future? Well, you probably ask yourself a question. What happens if you go back in time and meet your teenage mother before you're born and she falls in love with you? What happens then? You're in deep doo-doo, okay?
I'm going to be talking about physics of the impossible, and the book, much to my surprise, hit the New York Times bestseller list for 5 weeks running. When was the last time you saw a book? When was the last time you saw a book on the New York Times bestseller list with the word physics on it? Let us now talk about the impossible. First of all, the impossible has always been part of history. In the 1800s, this is Lord Kelvin, the most famous physicist of the 1800s. And he was asked about airplanes, heavier than aircraft. And Lord Kelvin said, "Bah, humbug. Airplanes violate the laws of physics." Also, "How old is the Earth?" he was asked. And he said, "The Earth cannot be any more than a few million years old, otherwise it would have cooled down. Impossible for it to be billions of years old, as Darwin and other biologists claimed." And then he said, "X-rays, ha! X-rays were a hoax. Radio, no practical application for radio whatsoever." So why did they make so many mistakes in the 1800s? And then in the 20th century, Robert Goddard pioneered the work in rocketry, sending rockets that eventually took us to the moon. The New York Times railed against Robert Goddard, called him a fool, said he was wasting money with these rockets because, said the New York Times, rockets cannot move in outer space because there's no air in outer space, said the New York Times. Well, we now know that the only hot air is in the New York Times editorial room. So I like to look at the laws of impossibility laid down by Arthur C. Clarke. He laid down three laws of the impossible. My favorite one is the third one. The third law of the impossible is, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So the difference between magic and physics is not that one breaks the laws of physics and the other one obeys the laws of physics. Magic is any sufficiently advanced technology. So I divide these into three types of technologies. First, we have class one, which are possible in 100 years. In 100 years, invisibility will become a reality. Certain forms of teleportation at the atomic level, starships. Today, I'm even going to talk about telepathy, artificial intelligence, class one impossibilities. Class two, impossibilities stretch the boundaries of the known laws of physics. Time machines, for example. Stephen Hawking tried very hard to prove that time travel was impossible, and he gave up. In physics, we have the expression, if it's not forbidden, it is mandatory. And then we have class three impossibilities, which simply violate everything we know about the universe, like perpetual motion machines. The New York Times, well, Wall Street Journal, often calls me on the phone saying that, "Professor, we have yet another perpetual motion machine that's making the rounds. Millions of dollars have been pledged by wealthy investors. Do you have something to say to the Wall Street Journal?" And I quote from the immortal words of that great philosopher of the Western world, P.T. Barnum. It was P.T. Barnum who once said, quote, "There's a sucker born every minute."